Hi everyone, welcome to our sixth show of Gargoyles Reawakening. We're excited to have you. I am Lisa, also known as Talia Levid on DeviantArt and fanfiction.net. I'm joined by Karel, who is known as Coda Leia.
Hello everybody, I hope everybody's fine.
And I'm also joined by Charles Jackson, known as Stand For Us.
Hello everyone.
And as a special treat, we have my friend Corky Dortch. His name is Bob Collins, and he's joining us from England. Say hi, Bob.
Hello there. Hello, everybody.
And unfortunately, Carol can't join us today. She had some issues with work scheduling, so boo retail. But hopefully she'll be back in full force the next time we're on. As far as news, Carol and I both have colds, so we sound like this. And we apologize in advance. But this is what you're going to get. So
I'm from North, you both my cough drops.
Your super Florida sunshine. That's what we need.
oranges too.
Orange juice. Yeah. Well, that we can get. But and then also as far as other news, we are excited on our Tumblr page. We've started a new campaign called Fan of the Week, and this is something exclusively on Tumblr. We won't share anything on Facebook or DeviantArt except to announce who we chose each week. But it's really exciting. It, you know, allows us to explore more of the fan base and promote them. And I really enjoyed doing this so far. We're on our fourth person this coming week. Today's the fifth when we're recording. So we'll have a couple new people by the time this show is released. But it's just really fun. I don't know. I hope you guys have liked it too.
Yeah, we do. I do.
Love it and keep wanting to going further with it, hopefully forever.
So far, we've only displayed a few artists, but I'm really hoping to get some of the fanfic writers in there too, because I feel they need some recognition. There's some amazing writers out there who just deserve it.
And they do too, because a lot of them feel like they're being forgotten or just not noticed anymore, and their work is fantastic.
Oh, exactly. And we don't want anyone to feel like that, so... So yeah, we are going to try to find a way to do the fanfic writers. If it means we have to post the fanfic, so be it. We'll do it. We want you to be included, not forgotten. Mm-hmm. And I say that because I'm a writer by trade too. I can't draw worth anything. So if I was in their shoes, I would understand how they felt.
Same here. Same here.
All right. And that's pretty much it for news. There hasn't been too much else regarding the fan base. Nothing new on Convergence. However, that is still open. So if you're interested in going, it's in Bloomington, Minnesota, July, the first week of July. I totally blanked on the dates. Thank you, Cold Medicine. But it's the first week of July in Bloomington, Minnesota. And it's going to be awesome. So go on Convergence link. We'll have it linked on our website. And hopefully we'll see you there. But to begin, on this month's Roar, we are going to talk about our clones. I wanted to talk about the similarities between the clones and the Manhattan Clan, but when you start to search for the similarities, the differences become really that much more obvious. They look physically the same, except for coloring, and they have the same voices, of course. But other than that, you know, the similarities are so far and few between. So we're just going to do a little compare and contrast, I think. To begin, of course, we have to talk about the master clone, which is Thalog. As everyone knows, he was created by Xanatos and Savarius in order to basically be the anti-Goliath. And they succeeded. He's as opposite as you can get from Goliath.
Even his name.
Yeah, even his name is backwards from Goliath. They just transpose the H and the T. But, I mean, even when Goliath has his moments with his stubbornness or his temper, you know that he's the hero. Ultimately, he is good. Whereas Thalog has been programmed to be just as intelligent as Xanatos and as strong as Goliath. But really, the fact is he's stronger. Say that again, Charles?
He's pure scum.
Oh, yeah, I know you hate him.
he's an uber monster, really.
But that's just it. I mean, this character evolved into his own character. Like, sometimes I forget he's actually
so
a clone.
So much so that even Xanatos fears him. He created truly a Frankenstein.
Well, and that's just it. You know, the other villains in this show, they at least have some redeeming qualities. But you get down to Thalog, and he's just pure... Yeah, he's pure evil. He's out there for himself.
Out of control and out of morals. Yeah.
Yeah. So really, I mean, he's the flip side of the coin
evil
from Goliath. There are no similarities whatsoever. And he's just very much in control of his own destiny. He doesn't need other people. You know, he's not even interested in being his own clan. And... I mean, he creates one eventually, which we'll talk about, but not in the sense that Goliath's clan has. I mean, they have that family bond going, and Thalog just creates a brainless army. Yeah, slaves.
Loyal, mindless, droning slaves.
They don't have a clan atmosphere, a clan relationship. He doesn't care about his clan members, actually.
No. It's very militaristic.
He uses everybody for his own benefit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's very militaristic or almost like a monarchy. Like, he's the king and they're just his
dictator.
Servants. Yeah, dictatorship. But yeah, I know he's Charles's least favorite character, which, again, I mean, that's
he's a perfect monster to use. When you think of a monster, immediately, Thalog. And right underneath there in the totem pole of just Rogue's Gallery is Severus. That guy, he's the animated version of Joseph Mengele, really. Just a real... modern-day Frankenstein, Dr. Frankenstein.
Yeah, he really... I mean, He really is, but in a way he's so campy too. Like, you know that he's capable of these great things. You know, he creates these other beings, he does all this genetic research, genetic manipulation, but he's so campy too. Like, you almost can't take him seriously until he releases his product. And then you're like, oh, this guy really is pretty scary. But if you just met him on the street, it'd be like, eh.
Yeah, he's just an arrogant git.
You mean Severus?
I don't know if Severus is really that arrogant.
Oh, he's very. He's thinking he's the world's greatest scientist. Everyone else is just beneath him and just his genetic tools to play with. If I could have your DNA, I can make you look like a complete moron and do my bidding.
And see, I never really got that out of Severus. I mean, yes, he wants to control people and he wants to create things.
He wants
but
to become
to me,
his own
almost,
god through science.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's more like a god complex. Like, he just wants to create these other creatures. Narcissist, yeah.
He's a narcissist. A genius narcissist at that. And sadly throws away his talents for his ego.
Genius and insanity border a thin line.
I know, and he prefers to go on the wrong side, sadly.
Well, and he does.
He does,
I mean,
is like, wow, I'm surprised. I'm surprised Karma hasn't already caught up with you yet, because, wow, you're right up there with Mengele. That's just evil. The angel of death. Sorry, I like my villains. I don't like them, whereas I root for them. I appreciate, I respect them for how evil they are, know how they think, and thus according how to handle them accordingly.
So, I mean, there is a lot going on with this arc. But yeah,
it's a vicious cycle of misery.
And, you know, going back to that god complex, I mean, Xanatos wanted Thalog to be fully functional. He wanted him to be very intelligent. He wanted him to be very manipulative. He basically wanted a mini-me, except bigger and stronger and able to do the muscle work that Xanatos probably didn't want to get his hands involved in. You know, he could be like, oh, there's this gargoyle being instead. But he got Thalog, who really is by far more intelligent than Xanatos, and he's just as strong as Goliath. I mean,
yeah,
he really is a true monster.
What were you thinking of that? You're going to create somebody who's like you, but as a gargoyle, yet how are you going to control him? He's going to go on his own thing, and there's nothing you can do about it unless you put some control on him. And Xanatos failed to do that.
Well, and I think that's partially where Xanatos' megalomaniac complex comes in. I really think he thought he could control this.
Yeah,
you know, I think he took one of his gambits and he failed in this chance. But you know, of course, Xanatos will move on with his life. He just moves on to Plan B or Plan C. But he always has that element of fear now because he really did create somebody who can outwit him, and that's not an easy task.
Good job, Xanatos. Good job.
Well played.
Who has two thumbs and created a horrible bean? This guy. But in retrospect, I mean, then Thalog turns around and does the same thing. As you mentioned, Charles, he goes in and he creates his own clan. And he wants them to be these mindless creations so that he can have full control over them. You know, he doesn't teach them basic concepts other than to obey Thalog.
Mm-hmm. You obey Thalog, nothing more.
Well, and the only thing that really wasn't basic was their fighting instincts. I mean, they're on full par with the other clan members as far as that's concerned. But he didn't put much into their programming.
Or personality, yeah.
Yeah, and you see that in The Reckoning. But later on, when you do see them in the comics, after they go to live down in the labyrinth with Talon and Maggie, you do see them more as evolved characters. I mean, they're not quite there. You know that there's more planned for them as the time goes on. But if you take a look at, you know, we'll use Malibu. I like using Malibu because
they start to gradually start to come in their own. But they had some... still recognition personality, they start their personality that's somewhat similar to their original origin.
They do, yep.
Yeah, so as the old saying goes, life finds a way, and here it goes, that even though they were programmed genetically from birth in a test tube, that they're the original thing, even though they've been altered drastically. You can't quite completely write out their DNA or their true selves.
Mm-hmm. Well, and you do see that, and again, that's where I'm going with Malibu. You know, Malibu, to me, he really starts to act more like Brooklyn. He begins to develop some of those second-in-command qualities. You know, he is a little more take charge than the others. Not as much. He's still very dependent on Delilah, who I'll talk about next. But he does start to develop those, and I also get a kick out of him that he's like the ladies' man of the clan. You know, he definitely starts to develop a little bit of a relationship with Delilah, and he's very loyal in wanting to follow her. I mean, he still follows Thalog back to the castle, and if I'm spoiling this for you, Charles, I'm really sorry, but he still follows Thalog back to the castle as they've been programmed to do, but he makes that free will choice to go with his leader, and that's what I feel that Brooklyn would have done. And you know, you do see more of the similarities to Malibu and Brooklyn, I think.
Can't wipe out that coolness of Brooklyn. No matter how much tweaking down to the molecular level of his of DNA chain. Yeah. He's too cool. You just make him docile and inept.
Well, and I do like to think that eventually Malibu would sort of be on par with Brooklyn. Like, I think he'll eventually have more of those tendencies that Brooklyn does. You know, more of the leadership, maybe more of the, more of the other aspects that make Brooklyn the cool character he is. But, you know, that of course is... What? I didn't hear you. Oh, the beak? Maybe.
that's where he draws. That's where he draws his strength and charm from, the beak.
It's all in the beak. Ladies yeah, love that has the beak. To be it. But also, I'm going to talk very briefly about Hollywood because I don't have much about Hollywood in Burbank, unfortunately. But also, if you want similarities, you know, Hollywood, he's Broadway's clone, and you start to see some of those sensitivities, I think, more so in the comics again. But even toward the end of Reckoning, when Hollywood is the one who's able to enunciate what now for us, I mean, you see that fear in him, you see that need for guidance, and I see that with Broadway too. Like, Broadway's a very awesome character. I really love Broadway, even though I don't highlight him very often. I should more. He needs more love. But
Yeah, it's true.
You do start to see that aspect of him. So even though Thalag programmed these guys, you know, they can't really fight their nature, is how I tend to see it, once they learn free will. And that's where we'll get into Brentwood. Again, I want to talk about Burbank a bit, but there's just not very much for him, unfortunately. He's Hudson's clone. I think there's maybe more for this guy later, but in the show and in the comics, he really wasn't overly proactive. So I apologize, all you Burbank fans. But let's get down to Brentwood versus Lexington. Lexington is, you know, this sweet, curious, incredibly agile little guy. He's so quick on the draw. He's the first one who learns technology. You know, and I think maybe it was probably the biggest insult to see something like Brentwood to him, simply because he is so smart and loyal and he has all of these great qualities. And then you get Brentwood, who's just, you know, barely able to utter two words. And he's just not obviously on par with any of the other gargoyles except for his own clan, which is the clones. And then to add insult to it, you know, Brentwood is the one who chooses Thalog's side in the end. And Lexington's even like, dude, you're making me look bad. But Greg Wiseman has said himself, all you have to do is look at Brentwood and you'll see more of the future tense. You'll see what future tense had in store. It wasn't Lexington that you see in the end.
It's like what Puck warned in the very end of the episode of Future Tense. And is it just fantasy, or is it just a forecast of things?
Yeah,
to
is
come?
Is it a dream, or is it a prophecy? Yeah.
Goddamn trickster. Ahead.
I love Puck.
I know he's awesome too, but at the same time, he's like, damn it. Stop screwing around so much, too. It'd be funny without constantly mind-screwing with me.
But where would Puck be without that? But we're not talking about Puck. I know. We're going to do Puck on another show.
I know.
But yeah, now, one that I do want to talk about, of course, is Delilah. Delilah is the wrench in this whole plan. Damona and Thalog, they talked about making this clan. Damona named them after California names, I think mostly to make fun of the ridiculousness of the Manhattan clan naming themselves after Manhattan names. But she didn't know about Delilah. And when Thalog finally revealed her, I mean, you could just see that hate and that anger of the betrayal and hurt. You know, I think Damona really felt that maybe this would work out, whereas Thalog looked at her as that unpredictable character that she is.
Thalog always did from the beginning, didn't intend to keep Damona around at all. Remember the episode where...
I don't think so. In the French episode.
Yes. Where you were trying to have Damona marry Macbeth just so to get control of both their assets, and you were just using her all along. And this is just his ultimate way of finally finding some use for her. Is that, oh, I got a clone of you, I can no longer need you anymore. Even though I might not get your assets, at least I got to use you to get something else I wanted. And now I got the best of both worlds of you and Elisa in one being. So, I don't need you anymore.
Did you ever see that as like an Oedipus complex? Like, hey, I'm making this.
He's a pig.
Right?
You expect. He's a pig. he's like evil incarnate, and that pig, and the piggishness comes with it, too.
But yeah, he does create Delilah as a clone of Damona and Elisa, and she's predominantly Damona. I read that he used Delilah or Elisa as cosmetic differences. So Delilah is a fully functional gargoyle, but what I love is that he really did want more of an intellectual match with her. He still wanted her to obey him, but he made her very intuitive and very intelligent and very articulate. Like, you know, she's the
some
one who I feel
of
will...
Elisa, not just the physical beauty, yeah.
To be right. Second in command.
Yep, she was going to be a created. Second in command. Yep. Mm-hmm. And to me, she's probably the most intriguing out of the clones, just because there is so much more to her. But she's still, of course, very kind of freaky, and the clan doesn't really welcome her with open arms either. although Brooklyn does try to go on a date with her, and Goliath actually does, but she makes her own choice because she has free will.
I wonder why she's called Delilah, because it has nothing to do with it's Samson and Delilah.
Lisa.
Yeah, but Delilah is a historical and legendary person, you know, with Samson. Mm-hmm. She's the one who cut Samson's hair and made him lost all his strength. So I still wonder why he chose this name for her, because
you know why? Listen, right there, as that description you just stated, he took a sample of somebody else, and not the full capacity of that being, just took a sample of it and of what he desired to make to get what he wanted. He didn't want the entire thing, because he knew that he couldn't able to fully control and possess it.
But that has nothing to do with Samson and Delilah.
Well, I know that on the GOG wiki they say that it's Thalia chose her name, and of course it's a mix between Dimona and Elisa, but
and Elisa,
it's about
for
all
the seductiveness
of the Old Testament.
The name sounds,
Delilah.
Yeah, it does sound sexy, Delilah.
Sound exotic.
Yep.
I was just trying to go for a philosophical point, by the way. Like you were saying, you know, DNA requires just a sample of you, part of you, and you know, I'm wanting to get rid of the main thing, main part of you. I'm just wanting certain aspects of you. That's what Thalog wanted. He just wanted certain qualities of both individuals in one.
Yeah, he did. He wanted
the full person where it has all the strength. He just wanted certain aspects. Well, and get rid of the other one. The other one he considers as weakness. He when he gets to what he saw was strengths that he desired. That's what
I mean,
going at.
Right. And it is because of that, of course, that Delilah, she does have the most similarities, I think, to Elisa. I really feel that a lot of Demona's personality was left out of it, except for maybe the strength and maybe the gargoyle instinct for protectiveness and fighting.
Yeah, who wants a 1,000-year-old raging harpy? I'm sorry.
I think there's some fans who do. I don't know.
Don't even remind me. I know what you mean.
Well, I mean, but that's beside the point. I think that in a way, if you really want a similarity between Goliath and Thalog, they both seem very attracted to Elisa. And Thalog mentions that in Double Jeopardy, where he's talking about what a beauty she is and how it's a pity she has to die with them. And I think maybe in a way that's kind of where that obsession began. I mean, yes, he takes it down a much darker road than the romance between Goliath and Elisa. But to me, that's like one of the ultimate similarities between the two, is they are both attracted to the same type of person. They both want, you know, someone who is very intelligent. They're intellectual match. They want
beautiful.
They want someone who's intuitive. And yes, of course, that beauty aspect is there. With Goliath, I don't feel it's as prevalent. I think that Elisa could have looked any way she did. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he would have eventually been drawn to her. Of course, it helps that she is gorgeous and she made an awesome gargoyle. because we all know that was the center. But, you know, Thalog, of course, is also attracted to this, and you see it later on with Sherry, too. And I'm not saying that those two have a romance, but he definitely wants his Elisa Mazza-type character around, or person around. So I don't know. I always found that a very interesting aspect to Delilah. And again, that's probably just my thought train, and nobody else will agree with it. We'll probably get like...
Elisa is, despite her, I mean, even with her looks, it's really her personality.
It's her abilities.
And her intelligence that shines the most. Even though, you know, she does look good as well, too. But really, mm-hmm. it's her strength and and wit.
That's
charm and appeal.
Yep, and I'm sidetracking, of course, but when you go to the very first awakening, And you see Lisa, yeah, she's gorgeous, but I was waiting for the April O'Neil who just, you know, she's there, she needs rescuing. What always stuck with me was how strong and intuitive Elisa is. And she trusts those instincts. She has those cop instincts. She's very intelligent. She's very formidable. And, you know, Thalag wanted that in his mate, too. So, I don't know. I think Thalag is the... Thalag
created
Delilah.
There's a big difference between being a police officer
Delilah.
And a news reporter.
Well, of course there is. But, you know, they could have made that character totally wrong. Don't act like they couldn't have. But they could have made all the characters horribly wrong.
I'm just joking. You know that they say TV rots your brain. And, well... Yeah, April O'Neil kind of proves that.
in a dark, sad world, they could have made all of the characters very wrong, but they didn't. But, you know, in retrospect, the clones really aren't that similar to their predecessors until the comics. And, you know, then you do start to see those nuggets of their characters, except for Brentwood, of course. Although, let's face it, if Brentwood eventually turns out to be as intelligent as Lexington, we're all screwed. Because I really think he's capable of quite a bit once he has that know-how.
I always say to this, like, damn it, Brentwood, you have to go wrong, don't you? Oh.
Master Thalag.
Thalag by himself is bad enough, and now you have to have it... a little evil minion of a genius too. Oh God, it's just we don't have enough trouble as is.
But I mean, in that case,
a whole new and it turns out to be a whole new villain. Coupled with Thalag too, it still makes almost like life is just not worth living around these two.
But that's pretty much all I have on the clones. I don't think you guys have any further. But again, I really wanted to talk about the similarities. One thing that they have in common is they really do freak out the clan. And you'll see that again and again. I don't think the clan was ever meant to really be comfortable around their clones. Maybe in the far future, hopefully.
Yeah, that's understandable. I think that anyone would be awkward and disturbed by this. It's you, but it's not you. It's a version of yourself.
A copy of you.
Yeah.
A perverted copy.
Yeah, yeah. I understand that it's disturbing.
The other thing, too, is their differences in coloration of their...
Even the coloration is awkward.
Too. It's just so opposite and random.
Their red eye, their black teeth, it's very... disturbing.
Very disturbing. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's
a more monster-esque look to it. Whereas the Gargoyles originally themselves, they don't look like anything in monsters at all. Where here, they actually start to look more so.
But it's again like they may look like monsters, but they don't. They're just misguided by Thalag.
Just misguided.
I think that's the point.
That's the point, yes.
Yeah. And it does make you wonder if they're... aging hadn't been as accelerated, if they would have become true clones of the clan. I mean, in a way, I'm really grateful that Greg Wiseman didn't go that route where, oh, we have Lexington's twin over here and he looks identical. I like that they have their own distinction. Mm-hmm. So you almost identify more with the individual character as opposed to, oh, that guy just looks like Lexington.
Yeah.
Well, the thing is that he, in the episode where Severus was explaining the thing about the clones, is that accelerating it did cause the opposite
photonegative effect.
Recessive genes to take dominion. So, what was the opposite where the originals? DNA has taken precedent because everything was so rushed over that the DNA that would have otherwise been you know, hidden away come to the surface. We'd be having to rush the process just to get the organism to fully develop instead of letting nature take its course.
But let that be a lesson to you. If you make a clone of yourself and accelerate it, if you accelerate it, you're going to end up with a photo negative of yourself. The end.
In other words, just don't play God. But, you know, you can't. What do you expect from that's what you expect from Severus. who wants to be God. Same thing it's with Theolictor, God in his own way as well. God complexes. Demona too, I mean, Queen of the Gargoyles, kill everyone else who isn't, or not loyal to her.
Anyway, we'll wrap this up, because we could go on and on.
Sorry, I'm having too much fun.
I know you are. It's okay. That's what we're here to do. But, I mean, the similarities are so far and few between. It just seemed impossible to actually do a similarities between the clone and the Manhattan Clan. And truth be told, I'm glad that these characters will eventually come into their own instead of being duplicates of the originals, because I love the originals so much, I wouldn't want a character to be identical to them. So I think that if we're ever able to see more of the show or of the comics or any format, I think it'd be really awesome to see where these characters are in, you know, even a couple months. Their birth line is very quick throughout the show and the comics. So it'd be really cool to see where they are.
I agree, yeah.
And that concludes our roar. So now we are going to move on to fan fiction. Take it away, Charles.
Hello, everyone. Today's fanfiction review for our theme on Halloween is Silver Bullets by Ellen Stolfa, which you can find on the Gargoyles fan website. Silver Bullets is a three-parter story, which each chapter is just gigantic. Huge fanfic story, which is a crossover between Gargoyles and Hellsing. For those who are not familiar with Hellsing, it's an anime that's like Hellboy. If you don't want to Hellboy, here's a full of what Hellsing is. It's a secret paranormal organization run by the Van Helsing family, who were famous for hunting and slaying vampires, and their overlord Dracula. In this case, though, they were able to capture and enslave Dracula to the point where they conditioned to become their basically living weapon, and thus created a secret organization around it called Helsing that worked for the British government in handling paranormal activity, mostly vampire uprisings and or anything else that goes bump in the night that threatens humanity. In this case, with Gargoyles, the storyline where it gets involved is that Demona thinks that she is plotting a vampire apocalypse to unleash on Manhattan, and through that, hope to spread this vampire uprising throughout the world. Whereas that it's originally, it was Thalog and the Illuminati that decide to start this event, and using Demona as simply a cover for this project of trying to manipulate the society, as well as a further big test of the Gargoyles that they can survive against a major paranormal event that they can control themselves instead of and observe. Seeing that the Gargoyles can't handle this vampire uprising themselves, they had to ask for Xanatos to help, and using what Illuminati connections that he has to contact British government, getting hold of the Helsing organization in order to bring over their secret effective weapon, which is Alucard, the conditioned Dracula turned ultimate vampire slayer. And throughout the story, you have them interacting with themselves, learning about Helsing, learning about the Gargoyles, and the Gargoyles learning about Helsing, and the individuals of about Alucard and its leader of the organization, Integra Van Helsing herself, who, in a way, like Elisa and Goliath, they too have a unique relationship, both romantically and as well as symbolically in their existence. Throughout the story, they also explore other aspects, too, where even integrating the Helsing universe with the Gargoyles, whereas that Alucard, when he was back in Dracula, used to know Demona, whereas she actually got involved in some of his medieval battles and interfered with them for both to enjoy getting her bloodlust as well as, you know, getting to screw over a major powerful human being that was Dracula at the time. So definitely you get to see a Demona and this Alucard actually go toe-to-toe with each other. While at the same time, getting to see the gargoyles work cooperatively in amazing ways, taking down hordes of vampires. And this is definitely the way this story is well written, both in the spirit of gargoyles as well as Hell's Kitchen. They both mesh in how this writer meshes the story well together. It feels it does justice to both universes, and they just work together almost seamlessly. I feel if there's any errors, I can't seem to quite find any. It tooled that well.
If I may interject there, on that note, I'm not familiar with Helsing. And the way that this fan fiction is written, I actually fully believe that these characters act the way that she had written them. She did a fantastic job with both genres, and and to me, like, a crossover is very difficult to pull off, and this to me was up there with Stephen Sobotka's. You know, it's just very well written, very believable, and I think that she definitely did her research on both fandoms.
Absolutely.
So kudos.
And I'm not even familiar too as well with Helsing. I only know a little bit from watching a few episodes I caught on TV years ago. I never got to read the comic books. So I'm not sure if this is more based on the comic books or the cartoon. I'm going on the basic knowledge of it. This is going to do my review of the Ninja Turtles Gargoyles part. I wasn't sure, but it was what season cartoon is it that's based upon, or it's from the comic books. But I was going on basic knowledge here. I'm just going on basic knowledge, but the way it was it's told, just like in the Ninja Turtles Gargoyles crossover. It's just done perfect, and the universe is just coexists without any hitch or hint that they exist in separate worlds.
And agreed. And, you know, coming from not knowing the background of Helsing, it actually made me more interested in the series. Just reading this and the way that the characters were not created, but the way she input them into the fic. She just did a great job, and I don't know how else to really say that without sounding redundant, but it did actually make me more interested in Helsing to read this fan fiction first, whereas I knew the background of Ninja Turtles, but that story was still amazing.
And the other thing too I liked about this fan fiction, other than it is so much to read and it's done so well, where both of these universes coexist harmoniously, is that there's tidbits of everything for everyone who likes in whatever aspect of story, and it focuses on each individual character as well too. They get their own little spotlights here and there. You got where you have there's a scene where Kitana is helping out with Alucard, just hacking and slashing through a group of vampire thralls, just executing them samurai style. Just going completely ninja bloodthirsty crazy on them. And then you have another scene where you have Brooklyn having to, Broadway, that's what I meant by Broadway. I'm sorry, I said Brooklyn. I'm sorry. I'm having trouble trying to remember what other things with Broadway. Treats Integra Van Helsing to a spectacular dinner that's fit for British royalty, particularly of Indian colonial cuisine. And you have where Alucard and Goliath constantly musing with each other about themselves as being leaders and their experiences of being ancient, powerful warriors, and their own different kinds between vampire and gargoyles. There's even an oddball yet curious subplot where Demona actually starts to take a liking to one of the vampire helpers in her conspiracy plot. You're thinking that she hates, you know, humans, yet here's an undead human being. He was a vampire, of course, still in human flesh, and she's taking a liking to him, having actually a date him. And what most of all gets me, too, is the historical aspect is where you're having Demona having to influence human history, where she actually got involved with when Dracula was just a human medieval overlord, warlord, that is, bloodthirsty one at that, and she gets involved in his affairs. And they can, that grudge from her interference carries on to him being the vampire super being and slayer that he is now as the Helsing living weapon. So for an excellent Gargoyles read for both Gargoyles and anime fans alike who want a story that feels just like eating through the best bag of Halloween trick-or-treat candy you've ever gathered in a Halloween night experience of your life, this is it. But I'd give a warning, though, is that it's like Halloween. It's not for the squeamish of heart. There's some suggestive adult situations here. It's nothing that's over, nothing that's to the point where it's very explicit and detailed. There's some suggestiveness, but there's plenty of blood and gore. I mean, definitely the Freddy Krueger, Friday the 13th, over the top horror movie blood fest, especially when it's involving vampires, mm-hmm. and the Helsing style. Vampires at that, too. It's real messy. Don't think this is just your typical Disney Gargoyles spin. This is definitely a darker side for Gargoyles.
It reads more like a horror book. Truthfully, it's sort of like a Stephen King novel. Like, you know that it's just for fun and it's dark and scary. But she does have those elements in there that will make you want to continue reading. So again, it's not for little kids, but it's a great read if you get a chance.
And that concludes my fan fiction review.
Thank you so much for that review, Charles. And now we're going to move on to our fan art section with Karel. Take it away.
So for this time, I focused on the spooky and Halloween things. You will see the topic. There are a lot of things, a lot of art about Halloween and the spooky things, but I chose several things, several art to show you this time. I can advise you to have a look on the art archives of MGC and maybe AMGC if you're interested in. I put some links on the website, so if you are free to have a look, you'll be welcome. And so I focused on several art and several pictures that I show you now. I'll start with some cosplay. So for this time, I chose to show you this Demona cosplay. It's been posted on DeviantArt this year in 2013. So it's a Demona cosplay by her name is My Bloody Dead Zombie. It's pretty accurate. My Bloody Dead Zombie, and I think it's a professional photography. It's from Sun Diesel Photography, and it's been taken at Dallas this year in Texas. At the Acon 24, maybe it's a convention there, or I don't know the Acon 24, to be honest. I must say that's a pretty good Demona cosplay. It's one I know that there were a lot of Demona cosplays around some conventions in the US, and I must say this one is pretty good. I love them. She has a very gorgeous face, to be honest.
You fall in love with her.
Yeah, if you can fall in love with Demona, I guess.
Yeah, exactly.
If he doesn't claw you to pieces.
That she has the eye of the beholder. She maybe has, I don't know if she has the Phoenix Gate, but I love the detail that she put in her costume, the wings and the tiara and even the teeth. She's very into characters, and that's what I like in this photograph. Very good one, yeah. Mm-hmm. And so the third cosplay I would like to show you, I'm unfortunately can't say where I found it and who is it. So if you have any information about that, I would be delighted to add the information on the website, because I just don't know where it was taken and who is. But I just love this Xanatos and Fox cosplay.
I honestly haven't seen this before.
Yeah, I don't remember where I found it. But this Xanatos is just perfect.
Yeah.
It's just beyond perfect.
This is such a testimony about how sometimes less is more. Like, they have very simple costumes, and they really nailed Fox and Xanatos.
Totally, yeah. Exactly.
And they probably just pulled stuff out of their closet, you know?
And grew a beard.
Right?
It could be a Disney-bound, but it's a cosplay too, and I really like about that, you know? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have any information about those two person, the where it was taken, the photograph, and anything, I would, because I, to be honest, I just don't have any information even on the name of the JPEG. It's a photograph number, you see, like a DSCF and the number of the photo. So I don't even know anything about it. So that's for the cosplay. You can find tons of really good cosplay on DeviantArt, and even if you Google Gargoyles cosplay, you can find tons. And I know that
you can find some even on YouTube as well too.
Yeah, from the even from the gathering, there were a lot of masquerade and a lot of cosplay. So feel free to have to look and to find some. There are a lot of good ones. And so for the next one, the next one I chose to show you this redraw. I really like. I saw that the screen cap redraw is something in the air now. I saw a lot of Sailor Moon redraw, and the concept is that you take a screen cap like this one that was taken to do this art, and you just simply redraw it in your style, and I just love the concept. So this one was made I think it's the Silver Lining, and it's very, very new. I think it was posted like 2 weeks ago or 1 week ago.
I was going to say, it was posted just a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, and it's just perfect for our theme, because it's just Halloween. The costume in the costume.
DeviantArt?
Yeah, it was on DeviantArt, yes.
Yeah, it was on DeviantArt.
All right, I don't remember, but I think seeing it there. I need to go back and probably find it. I'll make sure I definitely fave it.
Yeah, because it's very, I just love the...
Yeah, very accurate to that scene of the cartoon.
Yeah.
Bravo.
And if you can see the screen cap, you can find the link on the DeviantArt page.
On the art.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can find the link to to the screenshot. And you can see that she did a gorgeous work of reimagining it in her own style. And I just love the light and the colors in it. It's so...
I was going to say, I love the light and the colors. And I actually like that she gave them
the
eyes.
Texture.
You know, They have pupils, which is so rare. Usually when I see that, I'm kind of like, oh, they're not supposed to have that. But no, I really love how even their eyes are so beautifully drawn.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
And they have the pupil and the color.
Yeah, it gives them... Yeah, I know that. If I can remember well, they have black eyes. They don't have pupils. Yeah, you're right.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know that was something that bothered me, because I didn't know You know, when I was drawing my Paris clan, I didn't know if I could give them like split eyes or green eyes, or because in the canon they all have black eyes. So I really like
them. They do.
And they fit them. It fit them perfectly, the colors of the eyes.
It does. Like, you know, if they were turned human again, these are the eyes I would actually picture the characters to have.
Well, I agree. So, and for the last one, for my part,
yay,
I will show you. Yeah, it's been a long fan art section.
That's okay.
And for the last one, I will show you this AMV. It's from To Make
it's
Crazy.
Eye candy.
So it's put it in context. So it's from I just said it. It's To Make Crazy. It was posted in 2008, and it's about Halloween and gargoyles. And you'll see, it's this is Halloween done by Marilyn Manson. It's a cover of you know, the Nightmare Before Christmas. And I just let you see the AMV. Just let me tell you that I just love the fact that, you know, in most of the AMV that I saw, that I watched, they only use the awakening animation, you know, the five first episodes. And in this one, they use a picture and animation from the other episode. And it's something that I was looking for, and I'm happy that he or she did. So I let you watch it now. So here we go.
Of every age.
No, that was awesome, right?
Yeah, that was amazing. I didn't want to talk through it. I just sent you that message, too. I'm like, this is, seriously, this is probably one of the best videos I've seen with that song. And that's not bashing the other ones, but you're right. This one had a more diverse collection of the videos
of
instead
pictures,
of the first five episodes. Yeah.
And the editing
was awesome.
And rhythm was perfect.
Yes. It's up there with the Rammstein.
Like definitely one, yeah, of, one of my two favorite music videos in Gargoyles right there is Run with Rammstein and then this one.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so thanks to Charles that he pointed me this video that I didn't know about. So thanks, Charles.
A pleasure. Always willing to help
out. Charles.
Anything for Gargoyle fans. And you guys.
Pat on the back for Charles.
Yay.
So that's it for me. That's it for me, and
yay.
I hope that you liked it. So we'll make place for the interview.
All right, now on to our interview section. The previous recording, we said that Carol wasn't able to join us due to work, so boo on that. But the exciting news is,
I am here, all my faithful followers, to regale you with silly stories and voices.
And the good news is Carol was able to join us for our interview. I'm actually very excited because our featured guest is a gentleman that most people probably don't know. He's very, very new to our Gargoyles community. His name is Bob Collins, and he goes by Corky Dorch on DeviantArt. But he has been a good friend of mine for many, many years, and I was really thrilled when he agreed to be a part of our show. So here we go, guys.
Yay!
Hello.
Yay! Hello, Bob.
Bob.
Hello there. Hello.
Hello.
Good to see you. So I'm curious. I mean, obviously, you have a unique story in that you did not know about Gargoyles when it first aired back in the 90s, I'm assuming.
No, so no, not at all.
Yeah, so GFW and Essay and Gatherings, these are all strange words to you. So tell me how you got interested in Gargoyles.
I was a friend with Lisa for a long time, and we found that we had a common interest in another very, very good show that I'm sure Carell knows, The Mysterious Cities of Gold.
Oh, yes.
yes, a French production. And we sort of met through that. And then Lisa showed me a couple of the Gargoyles shows. I think probably only the first 7 or 8, I think. I was certainly shown, the famous episodes with the gun.
Oh, Deadly Force. Gotcha.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because I've actually been watching occasionally the shows with my mom. I've been posting on Facebook that she and I have been watching it, and I know we watched the pilot, which was the first 5 episodes, and then after that I believe was Thrill of the Hunt with the pack, and then
Temptation.
I don't think we've seen some Temptation yet.
Gargoyle is perfect for family bonding.
Absolutely. So totally. Yeah, so it was the pilot, and then the next 3 episodes were the ones that dealt with the trio individually. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I know we watched Thrill the Hunt and then
Temptation with Brooklyn.
So maybe 8 or 9, something like that then. So I can't think exactly the number, but I don't think it had ever aired in England when it was first out. So I'd never heard of it.
Hmm.
So I first saw it then, but when the DVDs came out, and I thought it was a good time to revisit it, and it's been much, much deeper than I picked up from just seeing those few, and that's something that's impressed me. So, so I've become a fan.
I think when I first showed him, I was trying to go for shock value, like, check out this grown-up cartoon we have, and I think
blood.
At first, right? I think at first he was a little terrified of some of it.
So, Bob, when you said earlier about the DVDs, again, and I mean no disrespect, the DVD of season one, the complete first season, when that came out, I think it was, goodness, it would have been 2004, because it was the 10-year anniversary. So right. In 2004, I mean, did you, were you in the know, or you,
oh,
you had no,
no
idea?
Oh, no, no,
okay.
No, I only got the DVD, oh, I suppose I've had it about a year.
Okay, and that would be the season one, and then season two, volume one, and then more recently, season two, volume two, I take it?
Yes.
Cool.
Yes.
So you didn't have to
got
wait.
All three at the moment, yeah.
Which is awesome. Sorry? You didn't have to wait, like a lot of us did. So that's...
No, that's true.
But I'm happy to have waited so that you didn't have to, and you could have it and enjoy it.
Yes.
That makes me happy.
So are you still in the middle of the show?
Yes, I'm the Avalon series.
Okay,
nice.
The tour, yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm. The latest one I've seen has been the one in Japan. Bushido.
Bushido.
Yes.
That's okay. One of my favorites.
Mm-hmm. And then
one of many.
Oh, sorry. Bob, I was going to say, are you familiar at all with the comics run that Slave Labor Graphics did a few years back?
Well, I've heard all about it.
Okay.
But comics generally is something that's always passed me by.
Gotcha.
So I've never read any of them.
Well, they're
it's
a bit
not,
hard to come by now, but if you
appeals.
Get them in trade, definitely recommend it. I mean, it's Weissman canon, so, I mean, if you think the series itself was good when it was out originally, then the comics just pick up right where that left off.
Excellent.
Mm-hmm. And if you're having trouble with that, you know, give me a scream or something. I'll be happy to try and hunt them down for you.
Oh. Yeah, they're on Amazon.
Oh, right. Okay, have a look at those.
Cool. So with Gargoyles, obviously the cartoon itself is like, oh my god, you're showing me deadly force. Oh my god, somebody's just been shot. What else intrigued you about the cartoon?
Well, I've always been a history buff, and the fact that it started in the past,
yeah,
I thought was very interesting, and I didn't know then how much it was going to revisit that.
Right.
So,
yeah, I was actually pretty impressed with that myself.
Yeah. So when it starts, you have this very, you know, dark opening, you know, with this terrible event.
Right.
And when I watched the DVD again after, I don't know, 12 years, I suppose it was, or something like that later, it was still very, very, very vivid. I mean, that terrible cry of anguish that
right.
Goliath gives. I mean, that's so haunting. I know it's in the opening titles, but that was something that I really remembered.
Right.
So I liked, obviously, the associations with Scotland from that first episode. But what's impressed me so much since then is how much it's gone back to that.
Right.
And has picked up on so many other parts of that, and also other things in the world to do the history.
Right.
How did you like the episode of MIA?
You'll have to remind me. I know the title
That's
of it.
That's the episode where Goliath goes...
Wait. He might not have seen it yet. It has...
Oh,
no, he saw it. Griff.
He saw it. He asked me about it. It's the England one with Griff and Una.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
during World War II,
okay,
during the Battle of Britain.
Yeah. Well, it's quite clear that a lot of thought was put into the landscape. I mean, the shots of London, and also in the subsequent episode where King Arthur ends up there. You know, there's a lot of very, very fine detail that the creator has obviously put a lot of effort into getting the small things right. And, you know, that's something that you don't always get.
I mean, you'd be surprised, too. Disney got away with actually painting on the actual German fighter planes and bombers that the Nazi swastika. I mean, Disney cartoon.
The US probably would have gone all over that.
Yeah, they had skull and crossbones, didn't they?
Yeah, as well, too.
And then especially for someone in your area, I mean, for Charles Leeson and myself, we're all from the US. You know, it certainly has resonance with us, but even more so with you, because that's more your history. I mean, that's Blitzkrieg. Everybody's taught that, I'm assuming, in the history classes in your area. Whereas it's with us, I mean, obviously we're taught Pearl Harbor.
Yeah.
But we're and we're also taught, you know, the Blitzkrieg, but for us it's more like Pearl Harbor.
Yeah.
If you get my drift. Yeah.
More personal with us.
London was terribly bombed in the war. I mean, it was
Yeah.
Yeah. absolutely flattened, and it went on, you know, night after night after night.
Yeah, I'd mentioned earlier that a few years ago that I had visited England, and I visited the War Cabinet Museums with my brother, and I was completely moved. I mean, I credit the England government for preserving that area, and I pray that they continue to do so, because that's a piece of history that we cannot lose. Englanders, Londoners can't lose it. Citizens can't lose it, because that's a very important part of everybody's history.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And I think it would have been difficult in any other sphere to put something like that into a TV show. You know,
indeed.
I mean, it was radical. Perhaps not for you so much, but certainly seeing it. If I'd have seen it as a child, I would have been quite surprised to have that portrayal, because it's all history, but it was probably something a little bit too raw for a lot of people here in 1994, 5, even then, to have shown it. So it was nice to see. But it had to have come from someone else. We wouldn't have done that, I think, if we'd have made it.
Right.
So that was good to see. Plus, it
understandable
story. Yeah.
Corelle here, she gets uncomfortable whenever I mention praise for the French people resisting against Nazi occupation.
Yeah.
Because,
and
you
then,
know, those were dark times.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes, yes.
Mm-hmm. And then, of course, I know in a previous episode of our podcast, we mentioned...
Sir Douglas Bader.
Thank you,
Douglas
Sir
Bader.
Douglas Bader. I mean, that's an actual person that Greg Weisman chose to put into not only that episode, but his Gargoyles universe. I mean, granted, mm-hmm. it's a real guy in a cartoon. Most people, you know, won't really think anything of that. But for somebody who's close to the core, like we all are, it's like, wow, that's pretty badass.
Hey, I take that into heart and give credit for that show. I mean, being a military history buff myself, and wow.
Yeah, so, I mean, so
Argos
obviously
takes an extra mile.
When he decided to do that episode, he did not take the subject matter lightly.
No.
So it's obvious that he did not, and then it shows in the episode itself. So certainly, you know, kudos to Weisman for that, because, I mean, like you've been saying, Bob, I mean, that's a hot-button issue for definitely anybody, but more so anybody who lives or lived in London at that time, or has descendants who heard the stories.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, quite. And it's the thing that's impressed me most about the whole of the show I've seen is how there's so much in it that's real. It's not, you know, he hasn't had to go and invent things to fit the show. He's used real things, real objects, real places.
Right.
Real events, yeah.
And mm-hmm. that's something I've never seen, well, apart from the mysterious Cities of Gold, I don't think I've seen it in any other show. I mean...
I'm inclined to agree.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I
think
any
that's
other
what
show...
makes it one of the best.
Yeah,
The episode in Egypt where they go to the Sphinx.
Right.
And Goliath taps on the stone to push the button.
Right.
To get inside the Sphinx. Now that stone is actually real. That stone actually exists.
Wait, it does?
Yes.
That is awesome.
Yes.
I didn't know that. I mean, I figured, you know, hey, cool gimmick and stuff. That'd be neat if it real, but...
No, you have a look at a picture of the Sphinx.
Gosh darn it, you're so cool.
It's actually there.
That is awesome.
Yes, it's a real-life ancient Egyptian stone. It was called... the Dream Stone, I think, because it depicts a story that one of the Egyptian kings had a dream.
Fascinating.
That the Sphinx had come to him covered in the sand, as it frequently was by the Sahara, and said, "If you clean me of sand, you will become the king of Egypt." So he did it, and sure enough, in time, he became the king and decided to set this stone up to say what he'd done, and it's still there. So the stone is actually real.
So when you say the stone is still there, I mean, it's not preserved in a museum somewhere. It's actually still part of the
Sphinx. The same place. Yeah. You have a look at a picture of the Sphinx. It's in exactly the same place.
That is so cool. The things you learn. That's awesome. My mind has been blown.
That's why I use them as a sounding board.
Genius.
But what other show would do that?
I can't think of any. Oh. At least not a cartoon.
And the episode in Prague about the golem.
Yeah.
Now, I understand that that is based on a true story. I must admit I hadn't heard that, but apparently that is a true story.
I know very little of the background of that story, but I do know that there are stories in Jewish lore about a golem.
Yeah, I think it's biblical. It's a biblical thing.
As my knowledge goes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a biblical story.
Yeah. But yeah, Greg Weissman knows a lot of stuff, and he, you know, took that knowledge and made it applicable, which is awesome.
Yes.
Yeah. What would you say, though, about the episode where they went to Easter Island and you just threw in the alien aspect?
You may not have seen that one yet.
Yes,
did you see
I have.
That one yet?
I have.
Oh, you did. Awesome.
Yes. I personally thought it was a good explanation of why those statues were there, but I just got the feeling that it opens up a whole new dimension that the characters should have been much more shocked to hear about. I mean, if Elisa has heard that gargoyles might exist, and then she actually sees them, and she thinks, wow, it's actually true, okay.
Mm-hmm.
But to jump from that to aliens, it's a very, very big step up.
And right.
They seem to take it in their stride a little too well. Angela, I thought, would have been, you know, absolutely, you know, bamboozled by it. Goliath would have been pretty shocked, I'd imagine, but he wasn't. But
in their defense, and I could easily be putting words and ideas into somebody's mouth.
Okay.
So as we were saying about the gargoyles with no car, in their defense, I believe my thinking is that Goliath and Angela really didn't understand that Nokar was not from Earth. I think they may have, you know, reconciled at the time, you know, how people kind of, you know, reconcile thoughts to make them believable, if that makes sense. They just accepted that maybe, you know, he's not a human, he's not a gargoyle, maybe he's just a part of the third race, and he's just calling himself an alien because that's what he wants to be known as. But, you know, everybody else, Lisa and any viewers would go, whoa, extraterrestrials, dude.
Yes.
So I think it was more something, and most of us know, Bob, I'm not sure if you're aware, but
misconception.
As Greg started his world building with the tour, I mean, Gargoyles doesn't end at the last episode of season 3 or with the last comic of the SLG run. It continues. I mean, he has the Time Dancer spinoff. He has Gargoyles 2198, in which the space spawn, which Nokar is supposedly defending Earth from, finally make their appearance. So I think as Gargoyles grows in Greg's mind, and as, you know, God willing, knock on a semblance of wood material, that we get some more content, we will see Goliath go, oh, he's not a third race guy. He's from...
Yeah, he's an alien.
He's from the stars?
Yeah.
Whoa. Mind blown. I have a feeling that if the series were to continue back in the 90s, or if the series is to add new stories or content, we would see that kind of a paradigm shift with him and Angela. I mean, Angela, all she's known her entire life is Avalon. So humans and gargoyles interacting. I believe she's even mentioned it either in an episode before the Hunter's Moon finale or the SLG run. She's always accepted humans as being kind. It was difficult for her to reconcile the fact that there were humans who wanted to kill her simply because she had wings.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So there was that.
I didn't know about all the other continuations, but actually that's the other...
Sorry.
Thing I wanted to share with you about why it's a show that it's appealed, the amount of planning that must have gone into it. You know, it's a testimony, I think, not only to the creator, but also to the network, I presume that's the right word, who actually picked
network
the shows up.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That you, if you're going to plan a story that is this rich and this deep, you have to know that you're going to get so many episodes to show it in. You can't be doing it on a week-by-week basis.
Right.
As some of these action shows, you know, I know that, you know, the Turtles, for example, they seem to be a little bit light on plot. Because,
exactly.
I would definitely agree. Having seen both the original 80s, 90s TMNT cartoon and then the one that was released come the new century / millennium, I mean, obviously the newer one, the one that was aired on Fox, not the Nickelodeon one, I haven't watched that one, so I have no opinion. The Fox one had more of a continuity, which I also enjoyed, but obviously the 90s one didn't. And in fact,
exactly.
I think in a previous episode, I mentioned there was a movie that Eastman and Laird put together, which included the 90s dudes, the new millennium guys, and the original comics guys, where they're all fighting Shredder, and it's not painfully obvious. It's what I said before. It was these people were gently poking fun at my childhood without offending me. Yeah.
That was so nice of them.
Yeah, it was very nice of them, and I love the movie. It was great, and I'd watch it again. It was funny.
He's like being poked with a stick with a Nerf ball attached to the end of it.
Basically, yeah.
But if you're going to take the time to make a very, very deep story, you know, you have to make sure that you've got the time to show it in. You know, and it's not going to get pulled at the drop of a hat, you know, as sometimes happens with TV shows, you know. So it's credit all round, really. But I understand that there should have been much more. There's this third series I keep hearing about, and
you're not referring to TGC, are you?
Sorry?
You're not referring to the Goliath Chronicles, are you?
That might be it, yes.
Okay. It's actually well known in... Well, I say this haughtily, but most people who watch the original series and then have read the SLG comics run, the Goliath Chronicles is actually not considered canon either by Greg Weisman or most of the fandom itself.
Fans, yeah.
Yeah, in fact, the first episode of the Goliath Chronicles, The Journey, was actually broken into, I believe it was 4 issues of the SLG run. Because that one was written by Greg Weisman, but the remaining episodes in the Goliath Chronicles were not written by Greg Weisman.
For the rest of the season.
And therefore, nobody that...
I don't mean to distance
anybody who did enjoy the Goliath Chronicles. Heck, I enjoyed them when they were airing at the time because it was more gargoyle stuff. But now
I agree with that. But I definitely noticed the drop in quality.
It's known as, in the Garg Wiki, it's known as Apocrypha. If I pronounced that correctly.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
It was an 11-issue run
Apocrypha.
Marvel. There were Gargoyles comics back in the 90s, and they were kind of weird. Yeah.
I agree with that one, too. I took a look at some of them online, and wow, I mean, this is really radically away from the Gargoyle formula. It felt like Gargoyles with much more darker. It feels like, definitely there was a scare way to the other half of the audience. It felt like, wow, it really tries to be too edgy.
In any event, I would recommend at least viewing the Marvel comics run, because that's still, if for lack of a better phrase, you know, Gargoyles history for us.
Yeah.
I remember, you know, back when Gargoyles first left the air, when my father... It was a regular thing. My father would have my brother and me over once every 2 weeks, and over the weekend we would go comic book store hunting. And I would, every comic store we entered in the San Fernando Valley here, I'd say, "Do you have the Gargoyles comics?" So it's kind of a soft spot in my heart for me to look for those things.
But
you don't have to read them.
Yeah. but all that, you know, it takes so much thought. I mean, he must have had this whole world planned out for a long, long time, and there's lots of references to other episodes, there's references to characters you haven't met yet. You know, that's so rare, I think, and I think that's why it's so good. But you have to have the backing of your paymasters to pull that off.
Right.
And, you know, so that's why I say it's credit all round, yeah.
Yeah, as the story goes, and I may be mistaken, but when Gargoyles first premiered, the toy sales were off the charts. You know, obviously the Disney execs were going, yay, more money! So they ordered the season 2 to have, I believe it was 65 episodes. And the Greg Weisman and his creator buddies, they were kind of, oh my god, how are we going to do this? Yeah. So that's when Greg started his world building. Okay. And then unfortunately, Power Rangers came to the U.S. around that time. And sadly, sales for the Gargoyles toys just plummeted as the Power Rangers toys, you know, rose to sky high numbers. And from what I've read and what I've heard and what I've gathered, that was basically the death knell for Gargoyles in the U.S. Because right. So he had the world building prepped. Unfortunately, Disney did not give him the chance to show that to the fan base he had created with the original show itself.
Right.
Because
yeah.
the toys that the interest, unfortunately, with the mass audience had died essentially in terms of the money.
Yeah. I knew that there was something that was planned that never happened, and yes,
right.
That's probably yes.
But, right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think he had Bob and I have talked about the spinoffs quite a bit.
Oh, gotcha. So you're fully aware that if Power Rangers hadn't come into the playing field, we could have easily had a Time Dancer cartoon. I think it is entirely possible that.
And that's why I hold a grudge against Power Rangers.
They are the opposite of everything I've just. Being praised,
yeah.
So
yeah.
Yeah, I can understand that grudge, Charles. Yeah,
my
yeah.
new best friend, Bob.
So now, most of us here, since we have the background from the original air, and me especially, we went onto the internet originally, and many of us have created our own characters that interact in the Gargoyles universe that Greg Weisman created. Have you followed suit, or are you more of, I like the show, but I don't necessarily interact with it with my own characters, or are you thinking of going in that direction?
Not at the moment, no. It's very fun to see what other people have come up with, and I've had the pleasure of reading some of those.
Oh, fantastic.
Yes, but... it's not something I've ever thought about doing. To be honest, I haven't quite got properly clued up on the background of the clan system yet. So, you know, I'd have to get it really clear in my head how it works exactly before I could do that. But it's very interesting to read other people's creations.
Oh, indeed.
Oh, yes, yes, yes. That's great. And it's a tribute to the show that people want to do that.
Right.
Long may it continue.
Now, forgive me. When you say clan, are you referring to the internet clans of the past, like Eminon and the Can Clan and Gargoyles? Or are you referring more to the dynamic that was created within the show itself of, like, the Wyvern Clan?
Yeah, I was referring to the dynamic.
Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah.
Because back in the day, there were basically the best way to describe it would be if you play a video game now like StarCraft or a Call of Duty and you belong to a quote unquote clan. You know, it's basically a list of names of people saying, "I've done this and I've done this and I've killed this many people and this is my score." That's essentially what Eminon and the Can Clan and the Gargoyles was like back in the day. You know, I do this and I have this many characters and they've done this and yeah. So you're thinking more from a story point of view as opposed to a
I think the story is the important thing.
My apologies. Does that mean then when or if you decide to kind of venture into fandom and fanfic, are you going to have your own clan, or are you just going to have a couple characters here and there?
It's much, much easier to write about characters that already sort of semi-exist rather than try to come up with something completely original. I'd say I tend to be a miniaturist, so I'd probably just have one or two characters rather than try to create a whole new...
A new sandbox with a
family, so to speak. Yes, yeah. I think that would be very, very difficult. I'll save that to the masters of the fanfic.
Awesome. But
one or two, though, would be nice.
Yeah, it's where you start. Yeah.
Yeah. So, the trouble is, though, is when you've got such good characters, it's very, very hard to beat them. I mean, I could come up with anything better than what I'm already seeing on the screen. I mean, it's everything. Yeah, yeah.
I'm sure.
You know, it's almost a case of being afraid to try.
I hear that. I know we interviewed Christine Morgan in a previous episode, and I had pegged her with the question, how do you do it? And I'm sure, I will swear up and down, Guardian, my Gargoyles character, her entire history and her and all of that, crazy character building stuff, can't hold a candle to Demona's pinky. I'm sure of it. And yet I still love Guardian. So it's, it's a thing of love. Mm-hmm. So, Bob, of the episodes that you've managed to see so far, have you developed a love for a particular character, or are they all just kind of one big happy family for you?
I think of the characters, Hudson is...
Yeah.
I like his style. I like his laid-back approach. The fact that he takes it easy when he can. He's embraced the television... And
yes.
Things like that. I think that's great.
Yes.
And having seen the first of the episodes, the Scottish ones, I didn't expect to find that. I didn't expect to see a character doing that. So that was great.
Right. Yeah.
I like his style. I like his manner, but. It's impossible not to see Goliath as the main one that we can relate to and share his pain. I think it's so acute.
The whole fish out of water.
Oh yes, yes, yeah. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Damn. I know all about that.
Gotcha.
Yeah, I mean, I think I'm, about 5'2.5", so it seems strange that I could possibly relate to someone, as big as Goliath. But he tries so hard. He's got, such an English quality about him. He has a sense of duty.
Yes, yes.
That he does things, because, it's something that he should be doing.
Right.
It's something he has a responsibility to do.
Right.
Even though it causes him a lot of pain.
Right.
And there's things that he just doesn't understand about his world. And yet he keeps trying. He feels it's necessary because he's the leader, that he must be doing this. So it's a sense of duty, even though it hurts him,
Right.
He keeps throwing himself into situations where people are shooting at him, punching him, and yet he has to stand firm. And that's something I can relate to.
Definitely. Now, forgive me if I sound silly, but the whole quote, "If not me, then who? If not now, then when?" I would definitely say that applies. Was that quoted by an Englishman, or is that just something that's just withstood the test of time? Because I know, and I apologize if I bring up any wounds with this, but currently in the U.S., the whole "keep calm" and ...
Yes.
comes from "keep calm and carry on," which, if I remember correctly, is what the monarchy had said during the Blitzkrieg.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. And then, like I'd said earlier, I'd visited the cabinet museums. The quote that Churchill says, and I'm going to mangle it so atrociously, never has so much been owed by so many to so few.
Yes.
Yes. The whole idea of, you know, for the greater good.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Goliath is like that in a nutshell. That's cool.
That's exactly how I see him, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Because he knows it's going to hurt him, but he just feels it's my responsibility to do this.
Right. To lead his charges into a world where they don't necessarily have to live in fear, or at the very least, you know, and I lost my train of thought. Shoot. Darn.
Yeah, but, you know, as the leader, you know, he always throws himself into, you know, a dangerous situation. He takes responsibility for it. He says,
right.
I'm the leader, so I must protect them. I must lead them. Mm-hmm. I must show them the way.
Right.
And
as opposed to...
Sometimes it hurts him, but he won't stop doing it because, you know, that's not his position.
Right. Yeah.
I think that's amazing.
Yeah, it's not... definitely back in the 90s, a character like that was not very common, definitely not in a cartoon, and I don't think really, I mean, granted, I wasn't really watching Law and Order at the time, I was too young and I didn't understand it, but even now as I'm watching other television shows, I think the closest one could get, and I mean, this is just merely an opinion of my own, the closest you could get would be... With the comic publishing company IDW has since rebooted Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, and I think if anybody who follows that, you will know what I'm talking about. I think the closest anybody comes to that to matching Goliath's sense of duty is Splinter right now, and I say that only within the context of the IDW reboot, and I would actually definitely recommend that book to anybody who's read Gargoyles and likes story. They do the IDW people, they've done a great job of combining elements from the original comic with the original cartoon with actual good storytelling. So if anybody's looking for something, I would recommend that. And then the only other person I could possibly think of isn't a person at all, but then Optimus Prime. Again, with IDW. IDW does good stuff.
They do.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
I read some of their books, but not exactly some of the titles that you were just mentioning. But I've seen some samples of the comic book issues, and they have some pretty good stories. They do a good job with Ghostbusters, Godzilla, Jurassic Park, G.I. Joe. That's one of their longest-going ones is G.I. Joe. It's been around for a while and still going strong.
I apologize. I wouldn't actually know. I don't think
I'm a comic book collector. I used to be a
right
reader.
I'm just saying the guy who owns the comic store I go to, I don't think he orders that anymore because the numbers weren't there for him. Mm. So I wouldn't know. I'm sorry.
Well, from where I am, I get all sorts of comic books on sale.
Oh, okay, cool. Awesome.
Well, comic book store is basically like Florida's Mecca for comic book fans.
Gotcha. Cool. So with Bob, now, as we've mentioned before, you have quite a unique perspective because you don't know about what happened, quote unquote, what happened during the 90s, like on the internet or the gatherings and stuff. What do you think about the Gargoyles fandom? Would you even consider yourself a part of it?
Well, I like the show. It's just that, you know, I've asked Lisa many, many questions about it because I've been watching the episodes, you know, one by one. And there's so much that you could learn about it. There's things that you don't pick up the first time. And
right.
Say, I've been making notes with the episodes and so on about interesting things that I've seen in them. And it's, you know, a true fan has much, much, much more knowledge than me. So I think the fandom is quite amazing. It really is. You know, there is so much to remember. I mean, there are so many characters, for one thing. I mean, there's a lot more characters in this than in any other show I can think of.
But here's an interesting question. You mentioned the true fan. Do you not consider yourself a true fan?
Well, I haven't got to the end of this story yet, so
I'll give you that.
I've seen the last episode.
But you love it.
Oh, yes. Yes, it's lovely. It's great.
I don't see why that wouldn't make you a true fan.
Well, that's
what I tell him, too.
Aww. No, it was interesting.
I agree.
Thank
you.
Oh, yeah.
And we fans would love to help other new fans become true fans as well, too.
We like to suck you in.
Yeah. Because we get tired of talking to people who give us blank stares about the dichotomy between the relationship between Elisa and Goliath.
Well, and you've seen some of the explosions between, like, hardcore fans. I mean, somebody will have a disagreement about the smallest of things. So it's really awesome to get, like, a fresh perspective on something.
Yeah,
Nerd Wars.
Yeah, we kind of get, I know we get kind of catty, so. And I'm
really? Oh, yeah.
I'm just as guilty of that as anybody. I did my fair share of hazing back in the day in the chat rooms.
Oh, I never did that, but I've had times where it's been like, okay, this isn't accurate. How can I nicely tell you? So I've done that before too.
No, this would be more like, I think Patrick Tomon even mentioned it, the whole idea of female gargoyle versus gargress. Apparently that is a hot button issue for a lot of people.
Really?
Really?
Apparently, I did not know that.
I didn't know this. I want to clear this up right now, so I don't get my eyes gouged out.
I know very little. It was just something that Patrick mentioned in passing. And see, again, this is why, Bob, I find you to be so fascinating, because you don't know this stuff. And really, when you think about it, it's kind of trivial. But trivial to someone who, you know, who's outside of it and doesn't, and I mean no disrespect, doesn't quote unquote get it. But, you know, for somebody who, like myself, who was in the chat room watching these arguments, female gargoyle, gargoyles, female gargoyle, gargoyles. It's like, oh my God, it's just a word.
But to people who like live, eat and breathe it, I mean, that's a huge difference,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah. So it's definitely talking to fans or people who, you know, who have just heard of the show, I love talking to them, because by this time, if nobody understands now, I love talking and I love telling stories. If you didn't realize this by now, then, well, I failed.
So what is it officially then? Female gargoyle or gargess?
As Patrick.
Yeah, I don't. Okay. I never used. I think I maybe.
I just hope he doesn't blow up on me.
He won't.
And then eventually Guardian became an Andujian anyway, so it was a moot point.
But I'd like to know too. You know what? I'm going to play devil's advocate on the Facebook group. There you go, Charles. I will ask the question on Facebook and we'll see what responses we get.
Ladies and gentlemen, give us your thoughts. Gargoyle or female gargoyle? So Bob, in addition to the fact that you're basically brain spanking new to the fandom, do you have any plans or hopes to attempt to attend Convergence next year?
I would love to attend it. I don't know. I really would. So I haven't been for a long, long time.
Because I assume you never attended a gathering then, correct?
No.
They were done before you.
Yes.
Well, we hope to see you at Convergence then.
Yes, it's July. Is it July?
It's July 3rd, 2014.
It looks like it's going to be the week or the weekend of the 4th of July holiday. So get traveling could be interesting in the U.S. So I wish you luck with that.
Thank you.
Yes. If there's anything I can do to help you, let me know, or anybody.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Is it a costume convention? Do people come dressed up, or do they just...
I believe
it's optional.
I was going to say, I think it's some of each. There will be cosplayers, but I'm going to be dressed in normal clothes.
Mm-hmm. And I'm going to be dressed... I mean, the closest I'll get to a costume, I think, would be I'll be wearing one of the gargoyles shirts that I've accumulated.
Yeah, that I've purchased. Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, from Hot Topic or from other gatherings.
Because there's some seriously good costumes, I know that. So,
You would have your mind blown a thousandfold by some of these cosplayers. Wow.
Yeah, there's a lot on DeviantArt that are, you know, amazing things.
Very creative.
Yeah.
Yes, yes.
So,
some of the cosmos put Hollywood to shame.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, Bob, yeah. I was going to say, if you don't mind, because I apologize, I completely glossed over this before. Tell us about yourself. I mean, obviously, we've discussed that you are not from the U.S., so, oh my God, you're automatically an other. Oh my God. So, what's it like not living in the U.S.? Just being the stupid American I've been before.
Well, I was born in Canterbury, which is a very historic English city.
Mm-hmm. I assume because of the, and I'm going to be stupid again, the Canterbury Tales?
That's the one.
Okay.
Yes, that's the one. Geoffrey Chaucer. Mm. Yep.
Chaucer.
That's where I still live. I got into history at school. I did university at history stuff. And I've worked in tourism a lot, so I see a lot of people from all over the world.
And a lot of stupid Americans, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah.
Asking you stupid questions.
Well, like one or two. Yeah, they ask some very, very good questions as well.
Oh, well, that's a relief. So we're not all stupid.
No, not at all.
Okay, phew.
It's nice when people find it interesting. That's the most important thing. If you're talking,
you
to
can
someone,
count me in. I'm definitely a history buff, and very well read and loved to learn. So,
hearing another
being as intellectually stimulated and informed is a big relief on my end.
That's nice to meet you as well.
Can you take this picture for us?
Yeah, I've been there, done that. Yeah,
I'm sure you have, and you have my
yes. That's a given with tourism.
I'm sure.
I always say, though, it's nice to be asked.
Well, there you go. At least, you know, as opposed to stepping over, God forbid, somebody's grave and saying, hey, let's take a picture of this tombstone. It looks awesome. And they're desecrating the burial site of a loved one, and it's bad.
Yeah, you get that sometimes. But
oh, people have no scruples.
I know.
That's so sad.
But, you know, it's supposed to be fun. You know, people don't want to hear a lecture on things. You know, they're on holiday. They want to do fun things. So part of the challenge is to make it fun.
Actually, that's a good way of putting it. I mean, they're there for a reason, but they're also there to have fun. So, makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh.
School children is a different matter.
I can imagine.
Oh, yeah.
School children from out away from the pond, or?
You meet all sorts.
Oh, okay.
It's a long way to come for some of those. But we've got two universities here in Canterbury, so you get a very wide range, you know, from all four corners.
Cool. Pretty bitchin'.
Yep.
So, Bob, to close, again, so you have quite a unique perspective. Is there anything that you'd like to tell us? Would you have some suggestions? Would you like something? Would you like to see something different in future episodes? Or just tell us how you feel.
I did like how you have done the features. I think it's very, very good to focus on certain aspects of the show. I think that works really well. But because it is such a broad topic, that it's nice to focus on individual things.
Right.
And I certainly think that the history behind the show, that could be one feature all on its own. I mean, you've got enough episodes to make a feature purely on that. I mean, there was any number of episodes I could have shared with you for that, not just the Egyptian one.
Uh-huh.
So I certainly think that that's a good way of approaching it. And certainly the fan fiction and the fan art, this is really good so that the other fans can get their work out there and, you know, hopefully reach it as much as a wide audience as possible. I mean, I'm sure that people do the fan art and they do the fan fictions, not just for themselves, but, you know, to spread the fan them around. And it's very exciting to know that someone else is reading your work or looking at your pictures.
Yes.
That's really, really exciting. So it's really good that you've devoted some time to that.
Now,
so I think it works really well.
Thank you. Well, thank you.
Yes.
Now, going back to the whole idea of exploring the history, forgive me, I know very little in terms of the dynamic between what was on the show and what is actually existing. Is that something that you'd like to help us with?
If I can, I'd very much like to, yes.
Cool.
I mean, would have you on the Roar, yeah.
Yeah, if you'd like to drop us a line saying, hey, can you talk about this one day? Or, heck, I mean, even come back on the podcast if you felt so inclined.
Oh, well, I would be delighted if you'll have me.
Totally.
It'll be a pleasure, too.
Indeed, Thank you.
Yeah, it would.
You've answered my stupid American questions. We're like besties now.
We are, yeah.
Okay.
Well, as I've always said, I'm here to help you.
Yeah.
Nice to be asked about things.
And I can attest to that. I use Bob as my sounding board for quite a bit of my writing, just because it is a fresh perspective. And if I am doing something historical, which, you know, a couple of mine are historical based, or his, he's actually been a wealth of knowledge. So I can attest he'd be an excellent resource for us.
Awesome.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, because, I mean, my love for the show is, I would argue, it's pretty much visceral. Granted, I understand that there's a lot, obviously, a lot of the Shakespeare lore steeped in it, and there's a lot of history, but I just love it. There's no one particular reason why I love it. I just do. So it's kind of like, oh, dear, what am I trying to say? You know, if I can learn more about it, that's awesome. So.
Yeah. Well, if you know that, you know, some of the details in it was something that must have been researched very, very carefully.
Right.
Hopefully people will appreciate the quality product a lot more.
Indeed.
Than if they think that Greg Weisman had just made it up. I mean,
right.
It would be pretty good, even if he had. But
right.
If you think he's actually, you know, worked all of these things into it, I think that makes it even better.
Right, because he made it real. He made it tangible. I mean, granted, it's still, you know, it's not real per se, as in like, oh, I am touching this desk. This desk is real. I can't actually go up and shake Goliath's hand, which would be pretty damn cool if I could.
Yes.
But it's just...
But
it's,
you could believe that this world exists.
Exactly.
And I'll go back on your Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. In the 90s, I loved that show, but I never believed it really existed. I mean,
I totally
lived for the show. Every time it was on, I'm like, yeah, great.
Yeah.
But, you know, you never once believed that these guys were really in the sewers.
Right.
Until later episodes. And then with Gargoyles, I mean, you walk down the streets of New York and you kind of look up just to see that maybe they're out there.
Oh, yeah. I know I've mentioned before, the first time I ever visited New York, I joked. I said, so where's the Erie building?
Xanatos's tower.
Yeah, that's the name of the
headquarters.
His headquarters and the castle on top. That whole thing is the Erie building.
Right. But if you've ever been to Scotland or anything like that, I mean, you know, it's a very, very, very sparse place. And it's very believable that, you know, such things could be there. I mean, the story of the Loch Ness Monster and, you know, the Irish episode as well. It's very, very fitting.
Do you have any shout-outs, Bob?
Well, I don't. No, I'm afraid to say there isn't anyone else I follow on DeviantArt or anyone who follows me or anything. To shout out for the creators of this podcast, because I've now seen from the other side how much effort it requires, how much time it takes to put the product together.
Oh, you should have seen this earlier. We couldn't hear anybody. We're like, what the heck is going on?
That was Skype.
We can't do a podcast without sound.
I was actually messaging him during that time. I'm like, I want to add you, but there's no point right now because we can't hear each other.
Can't hear each other, no. So I know it takes a lot of effort and time to put it together. The editing stage must be very, very time consuming.
Yeah, Carol takes care of that.
We owe that to Carol.
Yeah, well, that's wonderful.
She's our master.
It's not that complicated, but it takes time indeed, yes.
Yeah. So I hope
Lisa's
that your
the one is the
viewers,
mastermind behind it all. She helps organize everything, planning wise.
Yes, having seen it from them, the other side now, how much effort it takes to put this podcast together, I'd like to use the shout out to showcase the people who are actually part of the show. And I hope that your viewers appreciate the hard work that you put into running it, and I hope it carries on.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So, as I'm sure you can attest, it's a labor of love.
Oh yes. Yeah. Yes. So consider yourselves shouted out.
Well, thank you. We've never had
most
a shout out before.
Aw. I feel the love.
Thank you so much for joining us for our show. It was a pleasure to have Bob, and we hope to see you next time. Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.